So thank you so much for coming this evening and joining us for the Q&A for Have a Nice Day. I'm really honored to share a stage with director Liu Jian, who I think deserves another round of applause. So for the Q&A, I will ask a few questions and then we'll open up the floor for audience questions. And so I guess before I start, I would just like to introduce Liu Jian a little bit further. He was born in 1969 in Nanjing in Jiangsu province, and he established his own animation studio in 2007. He had a first feature-length animated film called Piercing One that was released in 2009 and was very well received, and this is his sophomore production. And previously, he has collaborated with other filmmakers such as Meng Jinghui and Feng Xiaogang, and he actually had a background in painting before he switched tracks to animation. So I guess I would like to start with my first question, which is, so you actually mentioned that this was, I think everybody finds it too, that the drawings are very striking. And I guess in an age that where everybody's very used to 3D animation, this is actually quite refreshing to go back to 2D and hand-drawn. Where do you find your inspirations in terms of drawing? And it seems that the first film, Piercing One, and here, Have a Nice Day, both take place in an urban environment. Is this your like point of departure in telling a story?
想了解一下大家都对这些3D动画其实都很熟悉，但是您的这些2D的手工的这样子的动画反而是非常的新鲜，感觉到画得非常的细微，所以呢想了解一下为什么会有这样子的，从您绘画的背景突然现在决定啊。 做一个动画的这样子一个导演，那也从之前的《刺痛我》到一直到这一部《大世界》来，一直以来都是以城市都市工业化这样子的一个背景来做出发点，那为什么会有这样子的想法做法？
因为我那个大学学的是就是中国画专业嘛，就是绘画嘛，然后其实后来也尝试了很多的一些。 艺术形式吧，比如文学啊，还有一些音乐啊，做过乐队啊，写过诗歌啊，然后艺术上面呢也是，版画、油画啊，还有一些，摄影啊，这些都已经做过了。大概是2007年的时候吧，当时可能做那个观念摄影比较多一点，那时候，后来就。 2007年的时候，觉得就是这些艺术形式好像我现在想要表达的内容啊，这些艺术形式好像都不足够了，所以我当时也在找一个就是更有趣的或者更有挑战性的一个方式，所以很幸运后来就找到了电影这个方式，所以为什么用动画就也是非常自然非常简单的，就是因为我是绘画出身嘛，所以对电影其实不了解，但是。 我可以把它画出来嘛，就是当时最简单的想法就是我来画一部电影，当然还是以一个艺术家的一个视角或者说一个工作方式来做的，就是一部电影也是当做一件艺术品来完成，这样的。So
I think because I studied Chinese landscape painting back in college, and I do think that throughout my development as an artist, I tried different type of mediums, different type of forms. I have gone into literature, music, poetry, and also within the the forms and the mediums. I have gone through, we got prints, we have got the oil painting and other ways of expressing myself as an artist. I think during, especially during 2007, I was doing many conceptual art projects, and I suddenly realized that these forms and these mediums, somehow they weren't sufficient enough for me to really express myself artistically. So I really want to find a new challenge, a new way of expressing myself, and that's why I evolved into filmmaking and take that on as a way to, as a new challenge and a new medium for me to tell my story. And I do think that since it's very natural and simple to think about, since I want to use film as a way to express myself, I have the painting background, I thought about, of course, then I will use animations to somehow paint a film. And I do see this as a not purely just as a film project, but I also see it as a contemporary art project, and I treat it as if that this is an artwork that I'm doing, and I'm just using film as a medium, as a form to express myself.
然后第二个问题就是说，实际上是就是我生活的环境呢，就是是一个非常熟悉的，然后是非常日常的一个非常写实的一个表达吧。嗯，因为我生活在现在中国这个急速发展的这个时代嘛，然后周围的你能看到的、听到的这些，都是可以反馈到你的作品中当中来。嗯。
So in terms of the backdrop of this particular film, I was informed by a lot of things that I'm very familiar with, that my daily lives, and it's a very realistic depiction of the state of nation almost in China right now, because we are experiencing this dramatic transformation as a society, and I really want my artwork to reflect that as well.
And my second question is that, and this is something I have also written in the little blurb that I had for our film today on the website, which is that my observation from watching this film is that there is this contrast in the rendering of the scenes. The characters who are the more central in the storytelling are very simply drawn with just a few strokes, and you capture the character of and they all have very distinctive features that you are easy to set them apart from each other. Whereas the background or the backdrop of each scene is so painstakingly drawn that they're so rich in details. You see every shop signs almost as if you're standing right there. You see the graffiti, you see, you know, the temple, even the grain in the plantain tree leaves. But everything is so memorable. You have a roadside construction and a little stray dog coming in, and then pee on the side of the curb. You have people scattered in the background as well. You have a cyber cafe, you have an artist studio as well. So they're all very detailed. So that creates this great contrast with your characters. And yet, even though the characters are very simply drawn, they are very complex in their personalities, in the way that they do things, in the way that they carry themselves. So I just wanted to see, is that intended, and why did you decide to do this way?
那他在这个影片简介的时候提到说，他观察到最重要的一个反差和对比，就是在你的对于人物角色。 和你的背景的一个处理的方式，那角色方面呢，就是这些人物通常是用非常简洁的方式，这样几个笔，轮廓就把它画出来了。但是你的背景方面呢，不管是网咖或者是这些寺庙啊、小狗啊，或者是这些植物的那些很细微的部分，都非常非常仔细的把每一个细节都表达出来。那为什么当初会有这样一个构想，构成这样一个反差和对比的方式？嗯。
其实，大世界还有第一部就是刺痛我，他们的这个就是现在呈现出来这个风格，其实跟我的绘画风格其实是一致的。嗯，所以那个还有就是背景 刚才提到的背景是，实际上在我的电影当中是非常重要的。它我觉得可能不仅仅是单独的一张背景吧，它应该是一个剧情的一个延展。就是大家可以如果仔细看的话，可以在背景当中可以感受到或者读到很多信息。然后这些信息对于这个故事啊，对于这些人物啊，都是非常重要的，非常有帮助的一个作用。所以相对来说，我的电影当中的背景会特别仔细的去刻画。所以我还是比较认真的就是对待这些细节部分。
So I think in terms of my first film, Piercing Eye, and Have a Nice Day, I pretty much reflect my own painting style in terms of how I usually express myself artistically using this particular styles of artistic expressions. But I do think that for me, backgrounds are very, very important because they are not only just serve as a backdrop of the story, but also they are the extensions of the storytelling, the narratives and also the plot lines. And if you really pay a lot of close attention to a lot of details that are depicted in backgrounds, you can find many, many contextual cues, not only about the plot lines, but also about the characters in that particular scene. So I do see this as an important part of the film, and that's why I painstakingly really trying to capture all the details that I want to present, I want to represent and also present with the detailed drawing of the background.
And the next question, I think, is a little bit more complex, and I think it's a lot easier if you're a Mandarin or Chinese speaker, but probably not as obvious when, as a viewer, it's a foreign language to you, so you probably can't tell the difference, so just bear with me a little bit. So there's a range of accents that's actually spoken in this film and then also in your previous film. And that is also something I find very interesting because I'm from a generation who didn't grow up with such diverse accents being spoken. Especially in a Chinese-speaking world, that there is a standard broadcasting voice and a standard broadcasting accent, very similar to, say, the BBC accent or the CNN accent in the English-speaking world. And that's different from your colloquial, you know, everyday conversation. So, especially with animation, so any animated works that you see today, whether it's Chinese-made or if it's imported, they will always be dubbed. And when they're dubbed, they will always also have the standard broadcasting accent in Mandarin. So so that's actually quite refreshing. And I was wondering when you were writing the script and you're developing the characters, and also when you were casting the actors, if you were keeping these things in mind, as you make these decisions.
而且有些观众可能，尤其是不会说中文的观众，可能没有办法去听到这些很多细节，就是非常的口音啊，许多角色都有不一样的口音。那可能对一些以我这个世代的成长的环境里面，可能也没有这样子有这么多口音的这样的环境，也可能会发现这样其实非常有趣的一个地方，就是每一个角色几乎都有他自己的一个口音。因为大部分的中文呢，你听到，尤其是特别是在动画里面，不管是国内动画或国外引进的一些动画，经过配音之后，通常都是用一些播报员这样子的标准的统一式的那种口音去做这些配音的事情。那为什么会突然会在这部片里面，是在剧本写作方面，或者在角色的这些发展方面，或者是选角方面，会特别去把这么多口音把它选进来，是什么样的过程，或者什么样的为什么做这些决定？
因为大世界嘛，它是一个现实题材的一个电影，是一个写实的，是来源于社会，就是我们当下社会生活的一些故事。所以当然我希望他的所有的无论是人的声音呢，还是这个环境的声音，也是来源于这个现实。所以不同的口音实际上也是一个非常真实的一个写实的反应吧。 因为现在的中国因物流特别发达的，无论是高铁啊还是其他的，所以特别是大城市有很多就是新的移民来自全国各个地方，就像我生活的周围，很多朋友都是来自不同的地方，然后他们说的话虽然是普通话，但是都是带着各自的一些方言的口音吧，所以这个也是非常生动非常有趣的。然后大世界里面呢配音的也都是我在南京的一些就是艺术家的朋友大部分，所以他们每个人的就是他们的背景啊，他们说话的腔调啊，他们的性格啊也都是不一样，然后我可以把他们对应到这个电影的一些具体的角色当中，所以是非常有趣的。
So this particular film, Have a Nice Day, definitely what I was trying to do is to be very realistic, and it's almost like the realism that expressions that I want to do with this particular film. And by doing so, I need to somehow capture what's going on in our daily lives, and including not only the characters, but also the ambient sounds in the background. So I really want to make it as realistic as possible. And I do think that in terms of the accents, it reflect that realistic essence of the film, which is this is how people talk around me, because now even in Nanjing you have, because the events of transportations and other means for people to travel, a lot of people coming from other parts of the country, and they work or they live alongside Nanjingers, and then I do think that they bring their accents with them, and that's very much in my daily lives. And I do think that every character is speaking in the same kind of Mandarin with the same accents, then it won't be as lively, it won't be as interesting. So that's why I'm trying to really capture the different accents, even though that they're speaking Mandarin all the same, they have very, very unique accents along with each character. And these so-called voice actors, they are actually, the voiceovers are my friends, artist friends in Nanjing. So each of them had his or her own personalities and accents, and I just somehow matched that particular idiosyncratic sounds and accents and personality with the characters I'm trying to create in this particular film.
对，实际上就是这种配音方式是从我的第一部电影就是刺痛我开始就是决定的，然后有了这些经验。因为刺痛我刚做好的时候就是以一种很常规的方式是找了专业的配音演员来配的，在上海找了以前也合作过的一些专门配动画片的一些演员，但配完以后就是拿回来跟这个动画合成的时候就发现完全不是我想要的效果，不是说他们配的不好，而是风格是完全不一样的。所以当时因为电影节的这个时间也日期比较紧了，当时我就在这怎么办呢，我说这个声音是不能用的。后来临时就想，是我一个朋友一个艺术家朋友给我打电话，听到他的声音，然后我就突然就想到一个主意，就是说我可以找我身边的朋友来配。所以从刺痛我开始就是这样的，刺痛我也是我的身边的一些艺术家的朋友来配音的，所以后来就这个是我真正希望的，我想要的，这个来源于生活就是真实的声音。然后他们配音的时候因为我需要他们就是原本的声音嘛，所以他们实际上对这个电影是一无所知的，就配音的时候只是告诉他们这个我有部新的电影需要你来配一个角色，所以他能看到的就是一个白纸一个黑字，就是他所说的故事这个台词部分。所以这个电影具体讲的是什么故事啊，他的角色是什么样的性格啊，什么他们完全不知道，因为这样子我觉得才可以还原他们最本真的声音啊。如果我给他看的形象，他可能会多少会受一些影响吧。
So I think this particular method in terms of using people in its own natural voice with unique accents when they speak Mandarin. It's very much starting from the first film because I learned a hard lesson. For the first film, I took the conventional route. After the animation, I then contacted professional voiceovers from Shanghai, and they dub or they provide the voice for the characters. And after I listened to the actual final product, I realized that this is not going to work. This is not what I wanted with this particular film. It doesn't go together with the style of the film that I'm trying to express. So, you know, at that time, we were pressed with time because we had this film festival that we need to go to and show the film. So an artist friend actually called me and talked about how we're going to resolve this particular situation as soon as possible, and just so happened that I'm listening to this particular artist friend's voice and suddenly realized that I can actually completely, it's not to say that these professional actors, voice actors, that they didn't do a good job, it's just that they don't actually work for this particular film. So I decided to utilize my artist friends and really capture their authentic, natural, their own voice. And that's how we resolved that particular first film situation. And then I learned my lesson. And for this particular one, I decided to continue this collaboration with my artist friends. And they knew very, very, they knew nothing about the actual plot lines or the stories about this particular new film. All they had is a piece of paper in front of them with their lines. And I didn't even want them to really know about the personality or what these characters look like, because somehow I think if they are somehow primed by those images and that kind of knowledge, they somehow cannot really express their natural, authentic, true voice as much. So they probably just read the line and reading it for the first time, and I trying to capture their voice as authentically as possible.
Right, so I would like to take questions from the audience, and we do have microphones on the side. So I see there's one question in the front, the lady in the black.
First of all, it was a beautiful film, and I think your drawings or paintings are spectacular. This is a technical question because I'm not an animator and I don't know enough about it. I was curious how many frames or how many cells that you actually had to paint to do this, and how long did this film take you? And for me, it felt very much like photography in many ways, and I'm curious whether you use any photographs in your paintings. Mm-hmm.
他觉得这边画得很胖，真的太棒了一部片子。那想了解他，因为他自己本身不是一个动画家，所以了解说总共画了几格。
从头到尾画了几个，画了多久时间把它这个完成起来的？那是不是有感觉上有些停格，感觉好像照片的这样感觉？是不是就是透过一些照片，然后得到启发，然后把它画出来？嗯，对，画了多少张？好像我还真没有就是完全统计过，大概是一拍二，就是一秒钟12张这样的一个比例。嗯，然后。
So it took about 3 years to complete the whole project, and I didn't really count how many frames that I hand painted. You can just imagine it will be about 12 frames per second, and that will be the numbers of the frames I actually created for this film.
还有就是有没有透过照片的这样子方式？
对，那个电影当中的所有的场景，就是跟实拍的电影一样，我都是先去采景，然后拍很多的素材，素材拍了以后回来把它整理，有一些删减，然后把它再画出来。So
just like other filmmaking or filmmakers, I will seek out and scout locations for each scene, and then when I scout the location, I would take pictures for that particular scene, how I want the story to play out in front of that particular location. And then I will make some editing decisions to do maybe omit certain part of the backgrounds, and then I will painstakingly paint every single detail of that particular scouted location.
Okay.
Another question?
Yes, I have a question.
Okay, sorry.
Yeah, go ahead.
I want to commend you on the animation. It was very realistic. Mm-hmm. But as far as the plot goes, I was longing for at least one character to break free from the chain of violence based off greed. And be, as a filmmaker, I plead with you and other filmmakers to, if you have violence, don't make it so graphic and so much of it, because the public is becoming desensitized to violence. It's very important in any story to find, someone must find redemption, an alternative to the greed and violence that's in this world, because it's just, it becomes senseless. So it's very important. I'm a poet, and I believe that we need to go back to redemption in our stories. It's very important. Thank you.
他就是一个，等于算是给你一个反馈。他觉得，这部片非常的写实，但是他一直觉得说，所有的角色几乎都在这个暴力的这样的一个轮回里面去，都完全连贯在一起，完全没有一个角色是跟直接。
那他觉得说很多对于暴力的写实的这样的眼线，会把一些人对暴力完全就是失去了一个敏感度，就变成说觉得是理所当然，觉得这就是生活的一部分。那他一直觉得说可能作为一个艺术家也许可能对这些部分必须要不要做这么明白直接的这样子写实的表达。那他觉得说尤其是对于剧情方面可能对除人是这样赎罪或者说能够真的是从一些悲观或者是复杂或者暴力的环境里面从这边从的脱身出来的感觉会觉得说是比较有正能量的一个感觉。那不知道您对这样子会是为什么会特别想说把所有的东西都是用暴力的方式把它全部联系起来，然后没有一个人是。
OK，补充就是暴力是受到贪婪的影响的保护。对，可能他因为是国外观众嘛，可能对中国的社会或者其他就是电影当中所传递出的其他的一些细节的，他不是很熟悉。实际上暴力在这个电影当中并不是主要的东西了。他是一个就像里面的黑色幽默一样的一些荒诞的一些暴力。暴力只是事件的一些表面现象。实际上。
最重要表现的还是在当下我们生活的这个社会，当下社会生活当中，不同阶层他们人本身人性的不同的反应。所以，I do think that maybe because it's in a completely different social context, and I do think a lot of Chinese audience might actually see all the details be depicted in this particular film as find it very, very true to its form in terms of what they have experienced in the Chinese society right now. I do think that as a genre, it's more of like a black comedy. It's a tragic comedy. So it's to me, violence is not really the focus of the film. I do think that violence is only the surface. Under that surface, you can really see a lot of different complexities of humanities in terms of greed, in terms of a lot of people trying to survive in all walks of life, and then being placed into this have and have not social strata, and how people trying to negotiate that and trying to make sense of it. So I do think that I do see this. The film is not intentionally trying to glorify or focus very much on violence. That is just a way to really look into what is beneath the violence on the surface, and trying to capture the Chinese society right now.
Because 对我来说，这部电影肯定不是一个警匪片或者说是一个犯罪片那样的一个就是纯粹的类型片嘛，因为这个只是可能他利用的电影的一些就是一些表象的一些技法。实际上要说的就是，比如说这个 电影呈现出的就是不同的人，各种人，他们为了这个钱，为什么会有暴力？也是就是他们很多的人，可能是生活当中充满了焦虑，充满了不安，然后充满了欲望，这样的一个社会广泛的一个呈现，这样的。
So I do think that this is not trying to. This film is not trying to be the very strictly be categorized.Like a crime films or like detective films. I do want this to be very much a film about how different walks of life, different people, that they are somehow acting in certain way with that particular amount of money that they think that they will be able to get their hands on. And violence is just a true reactions of how they think this should be resolved, whether or not it's because of their own anxiety, whether or not it's because their own, their greed, whatever motivations that actually motivate them to actually chase after that money, somehow violence is part of the manifestations of that anxiety and greed and dissatisfactory reaction mm-hmm. to the society that they live in. Yeah.
Okay. If I may add, mm-hmm. I can see where you're coming from, and but I would not categorize our first character Xiao Zhang, who is.The reason that all of the chain of events, I wouldn't see him as someone who had greed. I think he was put in a situation where he really wanted to marry his girlfriend, but the girlfriend is currently not satisfied with how she looked. So in a way, that doesn't seem completely selfish. I mean...I think he was trying to help somebody else. And that in itself, I think his motivation, while we can't say is completely pure, it's still something that I find not something I can quite relate to, but I think it's very humane. It's, well, if this is someone you want to spend your life with, then this is what he would do.For her. So that's my take, but...
他自己对他的一些解读就是说也许小张这个其实他不是以暴力这样的方式出发点也不是为了贪婪只是为了要帮助他的那个女朋友其实也是虽然说他不同意本身不会做同样的事情但是他觉得不是完全是利己而是有利他的方式去想的
Alright, sorry. Okay, go ahead.
Thank you so much for sharing this wonderful movie with us. And I can see there's a lot of black humor, and I personally think it's very interesting. And one thing I just wanted to ask is that I noticed that there's a lot of waiting during my watching experience, like the water, the river flowing from day to night or just dark screen. So I'm just wondering what was the meaning of that?
Talking about the water or...
The water, yeah, there's one scene, like the water flow from like night to day and then to night again. So mm-hmm. I was wondering.
他说这个感觉它是一个非常黑色幽默的一部影片。那但是你影片中有很多的一些停留或者是等待的这样的一个阶段吧。比方说在河流里面从日到夜，夜到日这样子的一个，为什么会有突然想会在影片里面穿插了这样子的一个？
对，其实大世界。里面有一些他说的停留可能会有一些就是空景的有些完全是一些背景包括那个第三部分开头那段江水实际上就像我刚才说的一样他们是一个剧情的一个一部分嘛剧情的一个延展比如说那段江水这其实也很多朋友问那段是个实拍的一段啊江水这段江水就是说为什么要这样处理然后时间会这么长实际上我是不太愿意就是把它就是非常具体化的来解释这样的东西我希望就是每个朋友看完以后有他自己的一些解释吧这样子比较有趣一点但如果说对于导演来说 你有一些意图的话，可以解释的话，那就是可以象征成人的命运嘛，就像这个大世界里面不同的人的命运，他们随波逐流的这样的一种感觉，就是看起来似乎自己可以掌握自己的命运，自己可以去选择一些事情，实际上是没有办法选择的。
So in terms of the scenes that you are describing, also for the third part, the third episodes, that you have this long sequence that actually it's not animation, it's something that is actually shot. And I think that the reason why I want these to be part of the film is because I do think that especially for the river part, I want it to symbolize the fate of a lot of characters that I'm depicting in this particular film, that it almost like in the, you know, you see the waves and the rivers and the going back and forth, and it almost as if someone just completely lose control of its own, his or her own fate, that you just go with the flow and somehow you're feeling adrift, afloat, because of the situation you're in or you put yourself in. And of course, I don't want to really explain in such a concrete and vivid and very, very sort of absolute way that this is exactly how you should interpret this, because I do think that a huge part of the viewing experience is for the audience to actually look at this and come up with a completely different interpretation. So that's basically why there are this sort of long take in between those action sequence.
所以其实这一段是比较悲伤的一段，就是这段是我写剧本的时候其实就已经有了，虽然它是 就是不需要用很多的文字来表达的，但是这个设定我已经有了，因为如果说你想到一些关于命运的一些感受的话，所以我有一个朋友就是在国内上映的时候，他是有代入感的，他看到这段的时候，他哭了，就是看到，他可能会感受到他自己或者说一些。 所以我不知道，今天有没有朋友就是能够感受到这个，就是如果你能想到这个电影当中这些人，他们为了就是追逐这个钱，为了自己的一些欲望，为了他所谓的他可能想通过这个来改变自己的命运，而最终他们的就是结果是什么？所以这个。 然后实际上又是就像江水一样，它是一去不复返的，是不可控的。所以说，就像这个江水，这个配乐一样的，其实是非常悲伤的一种情绪。So
for this part is actually probably for me the saddest part of the film, and I really want to, it's already written in the script that I want to have this particular part of film done in such a way, because I think that there's still certain things that cannot be expressed with words and can be only through visual images. So I, this feeling of people just cannot somehow escape their fate is very much how one, a friend of mine, when she watched this film, then she immediately called me and then she just said that she was crying and weeping when she saw this particular sequence. And I hope that maybe some of you, when you are seeing this particular sequence, you also somehow think about or associate this particular image with the pursuit of this bag of money and all the desires and trying to change their fates, but at the end somehow cannot really control the things that it's completely out of their controls, and they just feeling helpless and then feeling as they're trapped in their own fate. And I do think that's something that I want to express with this long take of the river.
I think we have time for one more question. So, okay, go ahead.
我能用中文问吗？可以。刘老师你好，那电影很棒，就是觉得给我一种两个词形容的话，就是荒诞和错位吧，就是很多小人物之间的错位，一系列的事件造成的一种荒诞，我很喜欢。然后我想就配乐的选择上面问一个问题，就是 电影里面的一些细节交代了，就整个事件是发生在那个川普选举的这么一段时间。但是您配乐选了那个张强的《我的八十年代》，就是时空上面就是会给人一种时空上面的错位感。就是您，这是你的这是你自己的选择吗？如果说就是有什么理由吗？嗯。
So the question was that it seemed to me that the film is very much about absurdity, about this feeling displaced, and also the question was about the score of the music in the films, and even though it's very much about the state of the nation here and now depiction, but the final song is my 80s.And somehow it's this displacement of going from right now, here now, to the 80s, and why you make that particular decision, why to have these two somehow juxtapose them in the same film.
我的八十年代实际上在我写剧本的时候，当时听到这个歌就已经确定下来了，然后就已经把它版权买下来，就说肯定是要用到这个电影里面。放在这个其实出现了两段嘛，前面出现一段，最后在片尾出现一个完整的。我的八十年代其实可以就是映照到这个剧情当中，就是刘叔和这个方元君这个画家，他们现在大家看到的现在的剧情是这样的，就是他们是对立的，因为他们有一些不可原谅的一些原因，但是就八十年代的时候。正是他们就是青春年少的时候，他们是最美好的时光的时候，所以刘叔也说了一些回忆以前的话，所以对于这个剧情上面是有一个这样的一个烘托的一个作用。
So I already decided to use this particular song after I heard about it and I listened to it. I really think that it really captures something in the film. I really want to use it. So I do think that it fits very well, especially for the two characters between the painter and his friend, the gentleman survived at the end. And I do think that if you really think about the 80s is the time that when they were both young and they were idealistic and they were good friends and a part of the film also the character is he was reminiscing about their youth and the good old time, good old days of their lives. So I do think that it works well in that regards in terms of using my 80s to somehow bring and tease out that particular plot line.
实际上这种就是感受也是一种时代的变迁嘛，八十年代到现在。所以也是一个无可奈何的一种感受吧。
Mm-hmm. And also it depicts the passing of time and going from the 80s to now, and it's also something that is completely out of our control in terms of not only time itself but also the changes and the evolution of the society.
So I saw that when I said I was going to take the last question, there were a lot of hands up, so I'm allowing one more.
首先非常感谢刘导这个精彩的这个影片，然后我想问一个更多一个您对这个六七代导演有的这样一个共同的特点或者是愿景，能不能做一些就是这样一些感受的分享。 So I will translate myself. So I want to I want to ask what's the shared vision or ambitionsof those sixth or seventh generation of the film director from China. Thanks.
你说的是中国的
中国第六七代的导演的
有第七代吗？我不知道有第七代。
我看到好像有写的，没有，就是我凑了，就是第六代导演这样。
我想现在讲的第七代就是大概算是八零后出生的这一批，他们把他现在算是七。
对，实际上对于电影来说，我才做了两部电影嘛，而且之前一直是做艺术的，也没有受过一些电影的专业的训练，所以对第六代、第七代这样的也没有真正研究过啊，实际上。但是部分电影是看过的，贾樟柯的、娄烨的，他们应该是第六代是吧？当然有一些喜欢的作品呢，还是有一些就是。
非常棒的电影。但是你要我系统的说这些可能是没办法，可能我对艺术了解更多一点之前的。对，那第七代我真不确定有没有第七代啊。
So I'm not too sure whether or not this, or I'm familiar with the films from the seventh generation directors in China, because myself as someone who is more in the realm of the fine arts rather than in the film industry or the film circle. So I'm very familiar with a lot of great work from the sixth generation directors like Jia Zhangke or Luo Ye, but it's hard for me to actually categorize in terms of the generations and also the work or the shared vision that you're mentioning, and just because I'm not very familiar with the newer filmmakers and also newer works in the film industry.
而且这个问题相对比较广泛嘛，如果我们具体的说，讨论哪一部电影啊，这样子可以可能多谈一点。
So if you do have certain films in mind, maybe it will be easier for me to make any type of comments and feedback.
好。
So we'll save that for another time. But thank you all very much for coming today. And